He's been here on the Carter plantation for 20 years, and he's never given a lick of trouble.
You got no right to be free, boy.
He is dependable, sound, and healthy.
Only a man's got a right to be free, and you ain't a man.
Do I hear $1,000?
I'm a free man.
Get up!
The legend of Nigger Charlie. They should have known that no one was more dangerous than a slave who had killed to be free because he had to keep on killing to stay free. West, Nigger Charlie ain't running no more. Rated PG.
Get up!
He tore a white man's world apart and said, no one is ever gonna own Nigger Charlie.
Game.
Somebody warn the West. Nigger Charlie ain't running no more.
Rated PG.
Get up!
Somebody warn the West. Nigger Charlie ain't running no more.
Nigger Charlie! Game.
The legend of Nigger Charlie.
Rated PG.
I say we keep sitting on Boca.
Jimmy, give it up. Give it up. It's all over with. If there was a deal, it's gone down by now. We blew it. We blew our warrants, and we blew our cover.
Listen, I know the deal hasn't gone down. I know it. I can feel it. I'm dead certain.
Last time you're dead certain, we have a dead cop.
Hey! Oh, hold on! Hold on! Break it up! Hold you! Free you two! Break it up! Hold on to yourself! What's the matter with you?
Son of a...
Jimmy? You wasted 2 months on this. No cars are coming in while you two guys are running around town. Now go back to work. You're off, special assignment.
Come on in here and see about this mess.
And I know you better get your ass out of my house. I bet not catch it in here in the morning.
All the screaming in here. What's going on, Rosie?
Dear, call the truant officer.
Don't be twisting on that child like that.
Hold the shit, I'll call him myself.
Ain't nobody gonna be calling nobody till I find out what this is all about.
Dear Billie Jean is my child.
What did she do?
All I said was that I'm going to college, you idea.
Turn her loose. I said turn her loose. Rosie, sure enough, Billie Jean is your child, but I got a feeling you're wrong.
You a lie!
You ain't never in your life called me a lie. And God's gonna whip you for that. When you're laying on your deathbed, Rosie, God's gonna whip you because I'm your mother, Rosie. I am your mother.
Dear, you don't understand what I've been through with these girls.
Rosie, you don't know nothing about nobody in this house because you're too busy trying to save strangers. If anybody just touch one of them gals off the street, you'll bring down the wrath of God. But with your own children, your own family?
Yeah, Mama, what about my own family? What kind of love did you give me to pass on?
You're gonna carry that to your grave, ain't you, Rosie? You're gonna whip me with that until it kills you or me, ain't you?
Dear, I love all of you. I did what I could for Billie Jean. Now, you know I didn't raise up for no dancing or shaking her tail in public.
God didn't make you perfect in your judgment either, Rosie. You could be wrong about Billie Jean. God knows I ain't crazy about her wanting to be no dancer either. But that's her life. Now, if she don't make nothing out of it, it will be her nothing.
All right, right on. How you doing? All right, all right. Taking you out here again.
I would like to mention that we have with us tonight in the club that joy man from KJLH, Frankie J.
So what are you going to do about me?
I'm gonna do what I've been doing, and that's nothing.
No, lady. Your eyes have been following me all over this joint.
Maybe it's because you walk funny.
Then you're a freak for a funny walker.
Anyway, I did hear you on radio today.
If you were listening to my show, then you had an experience. I produce, write, and direct my own material for both radio and television, with the chit-chat profundity of an angel, interspersed with the best music played on the FCC airways. And the FCC has got to check with me because I own the sky.
Would you?
Hey, that's some cigarette case you got there. Can I?
I didn't say you could sit.
I'm sitting because you are a lady from another town. You don't know anybody. You're beautiful. And I'm beautiful. So it's only natural that we would gravitate toward each other.
How did you know I was from another place?
Brilliant mind perceptions, that's what I am. Just another one of the things that makes me so special. What? You ever hear Tank Robbins? Tank owns this club.
And he owns and runs Argon Records, and he used to be ace football player.
So you're up on football, too. Next thing you got to get hip to is Frankie J. Parker, all-pro Doyle of the Universe.
Is Slaughter.
Baddest cat that ever walked the earth.
It's not only his name, it's his business.
I'm going to kill him.
Sometimes his pleasure.
You want it, don't you?
Yes, I want him!
The mob had a contract on him. The Fuzz had a warrant for him. They all wanted Slaughter. And they all got him. Is Slaughter. Rated R. Where the pavement ends, the West begins. Black Rodeo.
We walk side by side, many of them die. Nobody ever told you the world was trouble.
Black Rodeo, with special appearances by Woody Strode.
The first time that the blacks didn't run in to say, boss, the Indians are coming.
And Muhammad Ali.
I heard you just gunned down Wild Earth.
I'm not no switch, no poison with you, but we got one.
You ain't as dumb as you look.
Black Rodeo, with music by Aretha Franklin, B.B. King, Ray Charles, and Little Richard.
Oh, my soul.
If nobody ever told you there were black cowboys, see Black Rodeo, rated G.
The first black president of the United States, James Earl Jones, in Irving Wallace's The Man.
Black Messiah, Uncle Tom.
And either way out there, we're going to burn the living hell out of him.
The Man.
Jim Brown is Slaughter. It's... This dude is bad. And he ain't just fly. He's super fly. Yeah, super fly. When it comes to women, they come to him. He wants a big score. $1 million in cash.
This is a chance, and I want to take it. Now.
What kind of money are we talking about?
Not much. Now, then I took all this chance for nothing, because that's all I'm supposed to do, then they're going to have to kill me, because that ain't enough.
He's got eyes. Rated R. This dude is bad, and he ain't just fly. He's super fly. Yeah, super fly. He's got a plan to stick it to the man. He's super, super high, super dude, super fly. Bring it on.
Black Prince, I bless you with my name. You shall be Black
Black. Black. Black Avenger, rising from his tomb to fill the night with horror.
deadlier even than he. Warm young bodies will feed his hunger. Hot, fresh blood will quench his awful thirst.
What do you think of vampires?
More horrifying than Dracula. Blackula. Rated PG.
Diana Ross is dazzling as Billie Holiday in Lady Sings the Blues.
Come on, boys.
For whatever man may fear, I'm here forevermore.
Dramatic film debut, Lady Sings the Blues. Rated R.
You'll be at the premiere tomorrow. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Very good. Mr. Johnson was saying to me this morning, or yesterday, one of the reasons they're sponsoring this premiere is it's sort of, without having to come right out and say it, it's sort of their way of saying, this is one of the kinds of movies we dig, mm-hmm. you know, which is why he's getting into it. He also says he realizes that it's reaching a point where he no longer has an excuse. Not mm-hmm. Hang on. Okay. We can't close it, can we?
All right, we're rolling. Here we go.
What's your position on this new wave of black movies? Is it good, bad?
Well, I don't think anything is either good or bad. I think it has to have, nothing's all black and all white. There are tones. My whole feeling about... the rash of black movies that we've had in the past couple of years is that initially they served a purpose. They made the movie industry aware of the fact that there is a black market and that blacks will support films made for us and about us. Most blacks, I rushed to the movie houses too when they first started, for many reasons, because a lot of my friends were working and I wanted to see what they were doing. And after the first three, which I saw, Shaft, Cotton, Sweetback, I said, okay, what's next? The thing that disturbs me is that, you know, well, the movie industry is a business and they will go wherever the dollar sign is. My argument was, who's to say that a film that projects images of the blacks that are positive, that are realistic, won't make money? That was the consensus, and that was the reason why the trend towards the rash of films that are now dubbed blacks at the box office, and this is what determines the trend. There has to be a change, because all of the films are too negative. They're too negative, they're perpetuating images that, for the most part, are unrealistic. When I make the statement, people say, well, listen, whites have the same things. They have, you know, the James Bond. Of course they do. They have James Bond, they have their Godfather, but they also have their Sound of Music, they have their Love Story, they have their Fiddler on the Roof. They have a variety of films from which to choose. Also, we have been fighting negative images ever since I can remember. All our history deals with fighting stereotype negative images. And I think we had gotten to a point where we were just rising above that, and suddenly to deal with what I consider another level of stereotypes is putting me and my race back where we were like 100 years ago. And while I can go along with people saying that we need fantasy and we need escapism, we need more than that to be able to project images that are positive and characters that are realistic. Now, when we balance the scale, then it's all right. The scale is unbalanced now. It's all negative. It's all con men, dope addicts, dope pushers, super studs, super, you know, spades, prostitutes, you know. It's just all too negative. And we have to balance the scale. And I think with a sounder, it's the beginning of a trend towards changing the kind of movies that we, that's been and the kind of images that have been projected.
Since most all of the movie business is owned by whites, mm-hmm. most, if not all, of the money for making movies comes from whites. Mm-hmm. How much are blacks going to be able to do, genuinely do, to change the image of those movies?
Stop going to the movies. Don't support the kind of movies that are being done. I mean, we're supporting them. Do you know? It's incredible. I mean, I have been on this tour on and off since August, and across the country, I mean, people say to me, thank God for Sounder. It's about time. We're sick and tired of the other movies. But we are the ones that are going to the movies and paying the money and helping to perpetuate the images that the movie industry is creating. We have to stop doing that. We have to say, okay, look, that's enough. We want something that deals with some real aspect of our lives. You know, we have made tremendous contributions, not only to this society, but to the entire world. And that, some of that, the world should know about. I mean, can you imagine how shocked I was when I discovered that a black man was responsible for the street lights? I mean, whoever knew? I mean, school, they never tell you anything like that. I mean, I never learned that in school. I learned that in reading the history books. Now I learned that. I learned that a black man is responsible for the gas mask. The first open heart surgery was done by a black man. Nobody knows anything about these things. You know, it's just an unfortunate thing that the percentage of blacks who live in the ghetto and who are exposed to the drug pushers and the drug addicts and the prostitutes, that is the part of our lives that is blown up totally out of proportion and spread across the entire world. And this is the only image that they have of us. I was in Minnesota about a month or 6 weeks ago, and I was told that when I was going to Minnesota, I said, what am I going to Minnesota for? You know, who's in Minnesota? And I was told that they had a large black population there. Well, when I got there, I discovered that the black population in the entire state of Minnesota is 3%. I walked out of my hotel, and around the corner, Superfly was playing. The line was down around the corner three times, and it was predominantly white with a handful of blacks. And all I could think of was, now these people don't go to school with us. They don't work with us, and they don't work with us. They don't live with us. The chances of communication and learning what you are as a black man is like, and what I'm like as a black woman, are almost nil. They only have their knowledge, or get their knowledge, from the media of a film. Now, they walk out of that theater with a concept of blacks that is so demeaning and so degrading that, I mean, I really got angry just standing there watching it.
If this exploitation, as you refer to it, continues, should blacks at least be making the money off of it instead of whites?
No. I don't think that's... No, no. I think that... That blacks, now let's see how I want to answer that question. It doesn't make it right because blacks own the money, earn the money. That doesn't make the exploitation right. It's just as bad as far as I'm concerned. I'm not saying to discard these films altogether, but I think we have to get a balance. We have to get a balance that's real. You know, and if I decide that I want to go to the movie and take my niece or nephew or some kids, that I can say, okay, I open the paper and there's a Shaft or whatever on this side, but over here there's a Sounder, there's a black girl.
How you doing? Hey. No, man, no, man. is exciting. I've never had any experience like this before in my life.
Welcome up.
But not all blacks are happy about their new heroes.
Many complain that all that super strong, super violent, super stud stuff doesn't tell the full and complete story of black life. But not all blacks are happy about their new heroes. Many complain that all that super strong, super stud, super violent stuff doesn't give a complete and balanced picture of black life. Many say that blacks and whites are left with just another stereotype. One who says that is Junius Griffin of the National Association for the Advancement for Colored People.
Mostly everything about today's black movies I object to, because primarily they're part of the most insidious manipulation of behavioral patterns of any ethnic group ever recorded in the history of the movie and the film industry. This is an industry that first depicted all Indians as savages. It depicted all Japanese as Japs, all Chinese as chinks, and at one time in our history, all Germans as Nazis, and of course all other Orientals as gooks, and now it depicts all blacks as niggers. And we've taken one giant step from step and fetch it to super nigger. We have movies that actually are nothing but sophisticated and expensive commercials for cocaine. And I'm speaking of Superfly. I'm speaking of the way they have our women getting in and out of bed without having any kind of emotional involvement with the men concerned. I'm speaking of having pimps, prostitutes, and other assorted criminal types thumbing their nose at law, when those of us who are products of the ghetto know that the first organization, the first governmental agency we run to when we're in trouble is the law enforcement agencies. Now, whether the law enforcement agencies live up to our expectations, that is not important. The one thing, we need them, and we must insist that they serve us as they serve other communities. And we cannot take merely an economic view of blaxploitation. It is a moralistic view. We must do whatever we can to raise the level of consciousness of that consumer community out there that support these movies. We must let them know how they're being exploited. We must let them know how their behavioral patterns are being manipulated. We must let them know how the clothes they wear on the screen cause us to go in and buy clothes. We must let them know that the religious ornaments that our kids are wearing around their necks are indicative that they're on cocaine. We must let them know that the reason our kids aren't being busted for cocaine today, because the sale of it has gone up, is because they're selling magic shave powder and sugar crystals for cocaine so the narcotics agents can't bust them. These are the things that we should be concerned about. Wasn't a bad movie. The second Shaft movie I thought was fairly mediocre. But we cannot mere entertaining stories about that can be romanticized about blacks. We have blacks now who are heroes in the most unpopular and the most unwanted war in the world. What are we going to do about it? We have blacks who have done everything from being involved in blood plasma to making shoes. Hell, we've done everything in this country from pick the cotton to fight in its most unpopular wars. Someplace in between, I'm sure, that there can be movies made about the contributions that we have made to this American society.
How do you answer the question that it seems that the black audiences seem to like these movies and they go to them, and that's why they're being made, more of them, more of them?
Well, I doubt that very seriously. I have, the thing is, as I said, it's the most sophisticated propaganda medium we have. I remember back during the early civil rights days when we were seeking the right to eat in public, right to go into public accommodations. Well, a lot of people wouldn't go in because they had never had the experience of eating with whites or being seated with whites on buses and trains. And we always made an excuse. Well, I don't want to ride with white folk anyway because they smell. I don't want to be with them because, hey, there's something wrong with them. That is merely an escape, and I think some of us are so anxious to see blacks in meaningful roles, we are so anxious to see ourselves on the screen, that we will do anything, almost anything, to do that. Another thing, that some of us are in need of victories, that we will do anything to get a vicarious victory over the system, not recognizing that once you get through that vicarious thrill of seeing a black man beat up a white man on the screen, you go back and you face the same evil system that you faced before you went there. And that this is indicative that our leaders, our civil rights and human rights leaders, have always emphasized that we should always deal with reality and not fantasy. And we must deal with America and with the rest of the world just as it is, not the way we fantasize it to be.
Oh, that shoulder. Mr. Parks, why did you make Shaft?
Well, I made Shaft because I thought that the subject matter was interesting, new. I made it because MGM called me up and said they had a good property and that they'd like for me to direct it. I turned down the first screenplay. And they got me a writer of my liking to do a second draft, which I accepted. And I thought that it was fun and a change from what I have done in the past.
Did any considerations of the black... Did any considerations of your being black, the screenplay being primarily black, enter into your decision?
Not necessarily. I never have done anything artistically, professionally, because I was black as such. My work has been on a very general basic attitude toward doing something as an artist, not necessarily as a black artist. I worked for Life. I worked on all kinds of stories for 20-some-odd years with them, for Vogue, Fashions. I've done crime. I've done poverty. And all sorts of things that I could approach as just an artist.
Well, now you're being quoted as saying you wouldn't do another Shaft movie. Why?
Well, I wanted to change. I didn't want to... I think two Shafts were enough for anybody to do. MGM offered me a very good salary and a very good percentage to do a third one. But... I felt it was time for me to go on to something different.
Again, no considerations of any blackness or...
I think that, to be perfectly honest, there was an influence because of the great commotion that's going on about black films and so forth and so on, that helped me to decide that, well, maybe I should stop this right now and get into something else. I have put my agent on notice and studios on notice that they should send me all kinds of scripts now, not just black scripts. And I think that it's unfortunate that a small percentage of black people who have raised the row about black films as such are doing more harm than good, because I think, frankly, the white directors are going to step in and take over the bonanza if the black directors are continually beaten over the head for doing what they call black films by that don't reach the audience approval of the so-called black critics, you know. I feel that, now you take, for instance, so a white director stepped in and did Shaft. We have white directors now stepping in and doing some of the more important black films. I don't think that the type of criticism that the black films have been getting is all bad. I think some of them are, other films are bad. But I think black films should not be criticized as black films. I think a John Wayne picture should be viewed for what it is. A Clark Gable picture should be viewed for what it is. A Richard Roundtree picture should be reviewed as a picture, not compared with a Jim Brown picture, you know, as such, because both men happen to be black. What is this thing anyway?
Well, one of the criticisms that some blacks make of current black movies is that most of them are not what they consider substantial subjects, that they are all sort of frivolous black people playing James Bond, glorification of drugs, etc. They make the point, many critics of black films make the point, that they want to see black films with black people that involve subjects of greater substance.
Well, I think the black audience makes a decision as to what they want to see. You say James Bond. James Bond is James Bond. John Shaft is John Shaft. I don't think they have too much in common, actually. I think if you would look at both pictures side by side, that you would find out that John Shaft has a more serious appointment with whatever destiny he has, rather than James Bond, who flies around fancy airplanes and so forth and so on. But be as it may, I still think that the black audience is the audience that decides what pictures they want to see. If you make a picture, for instance, of Harriet Tubman, I doubt that it would get the audience that a Superfly or a Shaft would get, unless it was made extremely well. And very few studios are going to want to put up the money and take that chance on a Harriet Tubman. I'd love to do a picture on Harriet Tubman, but, so forth and so on. Or you take George Washington Carver and his Peanuts. Well, to get MGM to put up $2 million for that, I think if you want to preach, then you better put your own money up, your own preaching money up, because I want to make important films like anyone else, but I don't want my films judged as black films, and I don't want to be shoulder all the responsibility of the black race in one particular film. If I want to do a musical, I want to do a musical. If I want to do a comedy, I'll do a comedy. If I want to do a serious play about, say, Martin Luther King or Malcolm X, I want to be free to do that. But I want to have the flexibility to do whatever I want to do. And if that film does not have box office appeal, you might as well forget it, because that's what it's all about. If a film doesn't make money, you're not going to be a director long. The studio doesn't make money from a film, the studio isn't going to exist.
Well, now, a black actress recently said blacks ought to stop going to see things like Superfly and what she called some of the other crap of black movies. And then Hollywood would stop making them, and they'd make more black girls and Sounders.
Well, again, I must say that the box office speaks for that. I think Sounder was a very important movie. I think The Learning Tree, which was the first film of all of the films made, was a very important movie. But what we must remember, and I would like to say here that I think that The Learning Tree was the type of picture that Sounder was. It came along earlier. I'd like to see it come out now to see what the reaction would be. But heroes were cut out for me. They were William S. Hart, you know, Hoot Gibson, and all the white Western stars. I was told when I saw, you know, what the hell do I need this for? You know, what I mean?
Yeah.
And so I'll go ahead and do a Sarah Abel or something else, and you know. But I think,
you'll well understand why we're going to have to get rid of the cigarette,
yeah,
or we'll never cut this.
No, I understand.
Since you didn't have it before.
Yeah.
cut a minute. I gotta remember the question.